Hello again, everyone, and welcome back to Persona 4 Golden. Let's see if Teddy can really not fight.
No!
Okay, I think it's pretty obvious that he cannot fight.
Is this thing for real? This is so lame. We swore to find the culprit, and this is all the backup we get?
He's fuzzy, though. That counts for something, right?
Oh, yeah. Can I ask you something?
I'll help you up in a minute, Teddy.
Who's this Saki-senpai person? Someone you know?
That doesn't matter right now. Anyways, at least now we know Senpai might have been thrown in here. Maybe we can find more information, too. Let's get moving.
Wait!
What is this place? It looks just like the shopping district.
Well, this got creepy really fast.
What's going on here?
Some weird places have appeared here recently. Things are getting so tangled, I don't know what to do.
By the way, why are you standing so far from us? You better not be planning to hightail it if something does come up.
Of course not.
Completely trustworthy expression.
I mean, I can't stand too close, you know? I get in your way.
Man, they really went all out on this. But out of all the places in town, why'd they replicate this one?
How should I know? This is reality for the one who's here.
As usual, nothing you say makes any sense.
Actually, it makes perfect sense.
But if this is our shopping district, we're not far from Saki-senpai's. I knew it! This is the liquor store that Senpai's parents run.
The sign above the door, as you might expect, says Konishi Spirits. And by spirits, I mean the alcoholic sort.
Does this mean Senpai disappeared here? What could have happened?
Wait a second! They're here!
Oh, that's probably not good.
What?
Shadows! I had a feeling they were going to attack.
Huh?
Well, it's a crapshoot, but I guess I have no other options besides this crappy golf club. That was a lot better than a golf club.
Stay calm and listen.
Oh, but I guess I'm still going to use the golf club anyway.
Some shadows have weaknesses. If you can pinpoint that weakness and take advantage of it, the battle will be a lot easier.
I can tell this one has a weakness too. Try stuff out and see what works.
I'm just going to skip through these tutorials because all of this stuff is going to be explained, hopefully in my commentary, but the idea here is that this is a tutorial battle. This is just a chance for us to mess around, get the feel for the full set of battle options that we're going to have, at least in a simplistic sense. We have a magic attack, a physical attack, and a defense buff with our persona. We also have our standard physical attack, the guard command, and we can command Teddy to analyze one of these enemies. So let's try that out.
This one's tough! Hang in there!
Now, unlike the analysis feature in Persona 3, at least if I'm remembering it correctly, Teddy does not flat out tell you from the beginning what the enemy's weaknesses are. You have to strike each enemy with a particular element first. And if it does turn out that they are weak against that element, Teddy will remember that information, and he'll display it right away next time you encounter that enemy and scan it. Fortunately, the analysis in this game does not actually consume a turn, whereas I believe it did in Persona 3. So there's a trade-off. In this case, they serve up the enemy's weakness to us on a silver platter. It happens to be the only elemental attack we're capable of using right now.
I'll keep track of what attacks have what effects on enemies.
And as in Persona 3, when we strike at an enemy's weakness, we see that little bar flash across the screen with the character's eyes. It's kind of a Japanese visual device. It's something that you see a lot in anime and manga to, I guess, to express emphasis. And as in Persona 3, knocking down enemies gives us an extra turn. Unfortunately, while all-out attacks are still a mechanic in this game, we cannot perform one since we only have one party member right now, and they require more than one. We can, however... God, that sound effect! That blunt thunk, there's just something comical about it, which... I mean, I guess it fits. This stupidly oversized golf club is just about the sort of thing I would expect to make that kind of noise. It gets me every time.
Congratulations, Sensei!
I appreciate that they actually went out of their way to render that persona as a character model, rather than just in an animated cutscene. Now, this is something that bears mentioning while I still have an opportunity to do so. In every other case, and not just in Persona 4, but in Persona 3 as well, in order to be able to use a persona, each character has to go through some kind of ordeal or tribulation that involves facing the part of themselves which they've tried to suppress, to hide, to basically cover up and prevent others from being able to see it, but also that they've denied is a part of themselves. In this case, for whatever reason, our main character has gone through no such process and has in fact faced himself in a very short intrinsic event that doesn't really seem to have had much conflict at all. Also, that small red sign with three hiragana letters on it directly to the left of the door there says tobacco. So this is clearly just a run-of-the-mill liquor store that sells cigarettes as well. And another thing which I pointed out in the commentary with Nick is that if you look to use right, there are two vending machines. I mentioned in that commentary that I wonder what the soda in the vending machines of Bizarro Inaba tastes like. I guess it's a mystery the game will never address.
Whoa, what was that? Did I hear you say Persona? What was it? I mean, what did you do? Hey, you think I can do it too?
Well, maybe you should try facing your true self, and maybe you can learn how to do the same tricks.
Calm down, Yosuke. You're troubling Sensei.
Now Teddy has learned some respect.
Sensei?
Gosh almighty! You're amazing, Sensei! I am one impressed bear. I can't believe you were hiding such an amazing power. No wonder the shadows were scared of you. Are you the one who's able to bring people into this world? And that's what I thought. This is really something.
This raises an interesting point, though. If the power of Persona is what allows us to cross the boundary between this world and our own, whoever is throwing people in here must somehow have acquired that same power.
Don't you think so, Yosuke?
Dude, you call him Sensei and then don't show me any respect?
Sorry.
Well, your support wasn't bad, though. I gotta give you some credit for that.
Huh? Really?
All right. You two keep it up, and I think we'll be fine from here on out. Now let's get back to the investigation.
Right. About that.
Man, I wonder what could have happened to Senpai here.
That ominous-looking evil portal of death into the liquor store clearly does not provide any clues.
I wish Jeunesse would go under.
It's all because of that store.
What the?
I heard that Konishi-san's daughter is working there.
Oh my, how could she with her family's business suffering like it is?
I heard their sales have gone downhill because of Jeunesse.
I mentioned this point in a previous episode, but there is a great deal of resentment among the established shops in Inaba's commercial district that Jeunesse suddenly moved in, built this fancy modern department store, and as a result, all of the businesses in the business district are being driven out of business. Business.
Stop it.
That poor father, to have his own daughter working for the enemy.
What a troublesome child.
That's kind of a black and white way of looking at it, but I guess it's understandable.
Hey, Ted. You said that this place is reality for those that are here, right? So, does that mean this was Senpai's reality when she wandered in here?
I only know about what's over here.
Fine. Whatever's going on here, we'll find out ourselves. Not again.
For anybody wondering, those large signs are just advertisements for different types of liquor.
Saki, how many times do I have to tell you?
Is this Senpai's dad?
You know what the neighbors say about you, right?
Sure do, Chairman Ikutsuki. I mean, Mr. Konishi.
Aren't you ashamed of yourself? You're the eldest daughter of a family who's owned this store for generations. Is it the money? Or did you meet some guy there? Just tell me why you have to work there of all places.
I can't believe this. She seemed like she had fun at work. She never said anything like this to me. You're telling me this was how Senpai really saw things?
One of the unfortunate aspects of society in Japan is that they value not letting their true feelings out. Letting one's true feelings out in Japan is regarded as, first of all, kind of an inconsiderate thing to do. in a public place or in a way that others can see. But more to the point, it's also regarded as a sign of vulnerability and weakness, although that attitude is not unique to Japan. That's kind of a common attitude in many countries in some form.
These photos. Hey, is this... It's the photo we took the other day with the other part-timers at Juness. Why is it cut up like this?
I never had the chance to say it.
Is that Senpai's voice?
I always wanted to tell Hana-chan.
Huh? Me?
That he was a real pain in the ass.
Ouch. What a twist. But again, it goes back to the idea of not letting one's true feelings be known to those around them.
I was nice to him just because he was the store manager's son. That's all. But he takes it completely the wrong way and gets all enthusiastic. What a dick.
Pain in the ass?
Who cares about Juness anyway? Because of that store, our business is ruined. My parents hate me. The neighbors talk behind my back.
Given these points, I do not blame her for being resentful.
I wish everything would just disappear.
It's a lie. This can't be. Senpai's not like that. It's so sad. I feel so sorry for myself. Boo-hoo!
Uh-oh.
Actually, I'm the one who thinks everything's a pain in the ass. Huh? Two Yosuke's? Who are you? I wouldn't think that. Yeah, right. How long are you going to keep deluding yourself? Screw the shopping district and Juness too. You're sick of everything, especially living out in the sticks. What are you saying? That's not true. You put on a good show of being carefree and happy-go-lucky because you're so terrified of being alone. The more, the merrier, right? Gotta be surrounded by people to block out the pain of isolation. And what's this about checking out this world for Saki-senpai's sake? Ha! I know the real reason you came snooping. Stop it! Why so panicked? I thought I was just spouting bullshit. Or maybe I do know everything you're thinking. Why's that? Because I am you. You just came because you thought it sounded like a good time. What else is there to do out in this shithole? The world inside the TV. Now that's exciting. You didn't have a single other reason for coming here, did you? That's not true. Stop! Stop it! You're just trying to act like a big shot. If all went well, hey, maybe you could even be a hero! And that senpai you were so sweet on, her death was the perfect excuse. That's not true! What are you? Who are you? I already told you. I'm you. Your shadow. There's nothing I don't know about you. Screw that! I don't know you! You can't be me, you son of a bitch! That's right! Say it again! You're not me! You're nothing like me! Yeah, that's right. I am me now. I'm not you anymore, see?
Yeah.
I am a shadow. The true self. I'll crush everything that bores me. Starting with you. Get out of my sight! How long can you survive this?
This one's much stronger than the last type. Be careful! Whenever you feel threatened, just defend yourself.
So right off the bat, this guy wields the element against which we are weak. There's a reason for that as well. The elements of a persona are sort of regarded as signs of compatibility or incompatibility between people. And it's no accident that both Yosuke and our main character wield elements against which they are each weak. So they're kind of like each is the other's foil. And this is in terms of their personality. More to the point, though, we are now faced with a fairly serious situation here. Shadow Yosuke, especially on hard mode, is no joke, and they cut us a lot of breaks during this fight, which we are going to have to exploit, but it's still entirely possible to die here. So, before anything else, this guy is weak against lightning. So we're gonna knock him down. And use the extra turn to buff our defense.
Persona! That's not gonna work!
I want to stretch out my healing items as much as possible for this fight. And I want to take every possible opportunity to deal as much damage as I can. Because if he hits me with Winds of Oblivion, that can spell real trouble, and we're very lucky here because one of the breaks that they cut us is that if he does succeed in knocking us down, rather than following it up with a second attack, he will waste a turn on an event where he just laughs. Now, I discovered the first time I attempted to record this with Nick that following up with a second Zio does not do anywhere near as much damage as a cleave when he's down. And enemies do take additional damage when they're knocked down, so I want to capitalize on this as much as possible.
Don't underestimate me!
It's guarding its weak point!
Now, what Teddy fails to mention here is that this boss follows a very particular set pattern in which he'll guard, and on the turn after he guards, he will use Winds of Oblivion. So, what I have to do now is guard as well.
Get out of my sight!
And between guarding and the defense buff, the damage mitigation was significant enough that I didn't have to worry too much about being killed by that, even though I'm down to about a third of my health. The thing about guarding is that even if you have a weakness, an elemental weakness, due to your persona, guarding will prevent that weakness from being exploited by the enemy. And enemies in this game, although it goes without saying at this point based on what you've already seen, they can exploit the same system of weaknesses against you that you can against them. So it's about time for a healing item. I'm gonna knock this guy down once more. And on this turn, I'm going to use a medicine.
Pain in the ass! Get out of my face!
Now, this is going to spell some real trouble for us if we allow him to get this attack off. So, I'm going to knock him down again. Power charge, by the way. And this is the same in Persona 3 as well as Persona 4. Power charge doubles the power of your next physical attack, so I do not want to get hit with the full force of that. I'm trying to decide whether it would be better to use Rakukaja or just to guard for this next turn, because he's going to attack me either way. I think, actually, I might be better off saving my SP and just guarding.
In the ass.
I'm actually not sure how much difference that made over just using Rakukaja, other than saving my SP, which I definitely want to do. Rakukaja burns through SP very quickly, and I don't want to have to waste a turn using an SP restoring item. So I'm going to just knock him down again and follow it up with another cleave.
Soda.
And I suspect on the next turn he's going to guard.
Don't underestimate me!
Yup.
Here comes an attack! Defend yourself!
Alright, so we guard again.
You're getting to be a real pain. Alright, I'm gonna crush you with everything I got!
In spite of his boastful words, he still refuses to use his extra turn if he knocks you down beyond this point.
Out of the way!
And Winds of Oblivion would appear to be at least somewhat mitigated by Rakukaja, which is odd because I believe it's a magic-based attack, or an elemental attack anyway. And it's probably worth mentioning.
Don't give up! It's weak to electricity!
That they've consolidated all of the physical elements in this game. Whereas you probably will recall from Persona 3, physical damage was divided into strike, slash, and pierce. So they were really just basically three completely distinct elements rather than a single physical element. Whereas here in Persona 4, physical damage is physical damage. They don't differentiate between physical attack types. We have enough health to withstand at least another attack from this guy, so I am going to press my advantage. Follow up with the cleave.
Soda. Don't underestimate me!
It's going to attack! Defend yourself!
Not if I can stop it first!
Soda.
It's going to attack! Defend yourself!
I don't believe that one more cleave will be sufficient to finish him at this point, so I'm going to play it safe and guard.
That's not gonna work!
I love also that the shadow characters actually have weakened animations, or weakened stances, I guess. So I'm going to take this opportunity to knock him down again. And I might be able to finish him with a cleave now, but if I miscalculate and it doesn't kill him, I'm toast. So I'm going to play it safe once again and use another medicine. Because now at least I know I can absorb another attack. Oh!
Here comes an attack! Defend yourself!
And I don't even have to worry about it now. So I can guard this and then finish him on the next turn.
What a freaking pain in the ass! Get out of my way!
How about you
Soda.
Get out of my way?
Soda.
I love that encounter, which was clearly supposed to be against an extremely powerful enemy, gives us a paltry 100 experience.
Amazing, Sensei!
Granted, they also don't want us gaining ridiculously large numbers of levels this early on, so I understand why that design choice was made.
Yosuke, are you okay?
A bit of explanation regarding denying the shadow self here, because this once again traces its roots back to Jungian philosophy, at least to some extent. It's obviously been treated with some creative liberty by the writers, but the basic idea here is that when you tell your shadow self that it is not you, that's basically a superlative denial that it's a part of you. And by doing that, you sort of grant it autonomy from yourself. It goes from being a part of you to becoming an entity entirely its own. And when that happens, it takes its own form. It ceases to have your form, which is why they transform into those enormous, scary monsters. Because they're no longer the person from whom they originated, since that person denied them. They gain their own identity and their own shape.
Yeah. What happened? You're not me.
That thing came from you, Yosuke. You have to admit it, or it'll go berserk again.
All of these are viable responses, but I think this one holds the most truth and profundity.
Is that supposed to be comforting? Damn it. It hurts to face yourself.
It sure does, doesn't it?
I knew it wasn't lying. But I was so ashamed that I didn't want to admit it. You're me, and I'm you. When you get down to it, all of this is me.
And by accepting the shadow self, by acknowledging that it is indeed a part of oneself, and I guess making friends with it, because that's really the whole idea here, is there's a part of you that you don't like, that you're ashamed of, that you feel is reprehensible, that you otherwise don't want anybody else to see. So you hold it inside and treat it as though it's your enemy and it has nothing to do with you. But by accepting it and really coming to acknowledge it as a part of who you are, and maybe even appreciate it, you and your shadow self become of the same mind. And so, as we're going to see here, the shadow merges back with its host. And in that process, the host has gained mastery over his other side, which allows him now to control the fullest extent of his power.
This is my persona. We heard Senpai's voice. I wonder if that was something Senpai had been keeping deep down inside.
Undoubtedly it was.
He was a real pain in the ass, huh?
What a way to find out. Jeez, this is so embarrassing.
Well, what is it they say? There are other sharks in the sea, Yosuke.
If you weren't here, I don't know what would have happened. Thanks. Hey, Teddy. Could Senpai have been attacked by her other self here? Like how it just happened to me?
I think so. The shadows here were originally born from humans. Sometimes the fog clears, then they all go berserk. And you saw what happens next. A strong-willed shadow draws others to it, and a big mass of shadows kills the host.
So that's why people die when it gets foggy in our world.
Yosuke's pretty worn out. This world isn't made for humans. It's not comfortable for you here.
Clearly not!
I don't hear any more voices. I think we're done with this place.
Thank goodness.
Let's go back.
Yep, I sure could go for some takoyaki right about now.
Hey, Teddy. You said that this place is reality for people who enter, right?
And as a matter of fact, I'm seeing on my timer here that we are now a little bit over half an hour. So now that I can wrap the episode up without ruining the mood, I am going to do so. Thank you all for joining me. I hope everybody has been enjoying this so far, and I look forward to seeing all of you next time. Take care.